Our journey through the book of Ephesians, talking about the church in Ephesus, we are in chapter 4. We find ourselves in chapter 4 this Sabbath as we've gone chapter by chapter. We find ourselves in chapter 4. Each Sabbath, though, we begin with a classroom commentary from a specialized credentialed teacher. Today we have Mr. Albertson. He's a retired teacher, but substituting here on our campus. And Mr. Albertson, take us to Ephesus.
Well, in Ephesus chapter 4, starting with verse 17, the books keep moving around. It's hard to find them. Starting with 17, so I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That's not a very complimentary statement. So I wonder what they were doing. Was it work? Was it leisure? Was it watching the theater? Was it walking the dog? Was it eating? Was it school? Was it worship? Was it politics? Oh, I was supposed to say that today, maybe. We took a trip, my wife and I, in 2012 to the Mediterranean area, and one of our stops was at Ephesus. Very delightful place to go, even though it's in ruins. Fell into disrepair, an earthquake pretty well knocked everything down, and what had been a harbor had filled in, and so it no longer was attached to the ocean. And I took a few pictures. Let's see, the first one is the Temple of Hadrian, and they're beginning to set up the rocks, number them and set them back up. I hope that if you visit there, you're not there when they have an earthquake, because some of those are going to come back down, and they'll have to start over. The second one is the Temple of Domitian, and perhaps you can see it's a little bit in the distance there, but you can see the rocks all set out in order, maybe you can see that, and they're beginning to assemble some of those things. So as you follow the tour guide, there's this temple and that temple and the other temple, and so I'm wondering, were they really religious people, always going to church? Maybe you would get that idea even here. When you drive down the street, there's this church and that synagogue and the other church. And then I have a picture of the theater where Paul spoke. They're reconstructing it. There, as we looked, we could see them working on the reconstruction. It actually held 25,000 people. That's a healthy crowd, isn't it? And would you like to speak to 25,000 people without a PA system? It's kind of built into the hill, so there's nothing behind it, but quite an impressive place. It's no wonder that when they were in riot mode, Paul was escorted away. You better not speak to them tonight. This might be dangerous. I'm not sure how many rocks they carried in. The next picture I have is of Harbor Street, and at the bottom, as I said before, it used to touched the water, eventually filled in with silt. And there were 50 streetlights on the sides of this street. What a magnificent thing that must have been. And a sewer system beneath it. And then the next picture I have is of the library, the Celsus Library. Those things look rather precarious sitting up there, stacked on top of each other again, with maybe no bolts. But this library held 12,000 scrolls. 12,000 scrolls. That's, think, how much room would it take to hold 12,000 scrolls? Recently, we've been working on a library, my wife and I, cataloging a library for the Voice of Prophecy, and it's quite an aggravation when books sit up without a bookend and they're always falling over. Have you noticed that crashing onto the shelf? And can't they make books that sit up and don't always tip over? They should make them fatter on the bottom, maybe with covers that spread out or something, so that the books wouldn't... What would it be like to, with scrolls? You take one scroll out and there goes the whole shelf rolling off the end. Now you have to pick up all of those scrolls. And my next picture, maybe shouldn't show it here, but it's La Triana and the village restroom. And you could see my picture didn't quite catch maybe the most important part. Off to the left there where the people are looking, there's a platform there, and they provide a string quartet. That's really a good idea. We need to talk to some city engineers to fix that. So you begin to wonder, what was life really like? Maybe go back one picture, it wouldn't be so... there we go. What was life really like in Ephesus? During the Greek time, only the boys could go to school. They had a uniform. The girls could not attend. Then in the Roman time, they both could. And what was it really like? You know, there's books like this. It says the everyday life through the ages, or life and times of Jesus, or the life and times of Elizabethan England, or life and times of the Reformation. And so if, say, 50 or 100 years from today, maybe Loveland will just be in rubble. What would you write in the life and times of Loveland? Or choose your hometown. What would be written in life and times of Topeka or Des Moines or Fargo, or I don't know which town. Pick a town, and what would you write for the life and times? You have some paper. There's in your bulletin. There's a flyer on the back side. I think it's free, and you have a pencil. Would you make an outline? Just don't begin to write yet, because we don't have time. They'll shut off my mic pretty soon. But just make a little outline of what you would include in the life and times of your town, maybe your hometown, maybe Loveland or Boulder or What are you going to write? Do you have a pencil? Mm. Make a little outline. What do you think of? Someone shout out, what would you include?
Art.
Okay. Include the art. We have Sculpture Park. Maybe that would still be there. Other things. Pardon?
Farmland.
The farms. Okay. Something else. The life and times of Loveland or Houston or something. The lake,
university.
Okay, the university, the schooling,
industry.
Mm-hmm. Where they make the 3D printers on the north side of Loveland there.
Churches.
The churches, worship,
schools,
hospital. Yes, literature evangelism. Your book might be pretty thick, huh? He started writing the life and times of today. Maybe even the trail to walk the dog still there with the dispensers of the plastic bags. Well, think about that when you read Ephesians, how Paul was saying you shouldn't live like those people. There's a better way to live. And the life and times of maybe your family can be improved, and your town can be improved. There'll be a quiz tomorrow.
Thank you, Ken. Let's go, Ephesians chapter 4. Open your Bibles. Ephesians chapter 4. I've had 2 weeks just to reflect on this one chapter and two very long plane rides to read. Ephesians chapter 4. If I were to preach on Ephesians chapter 4 was the question that rolled in my mind. If I were to teach a lesson from this chapter, what would it be? One thing from this chapter. So I started making my way through the book of Ephesians, chapter 4 of the book of Ephesians. And I came to verse 1, Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 1. I, therefore, the prisoner. You see that word? The prisoner of the Lord. Prisoner? That would make a great teaching. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 1. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, says Paul. What a powerful line. Because you and I know what prisoners are. Their lives are totally dictated. What they wear, mandated. What they eat, it's up to somebody else. Where they go, how they spend their time, their existence is controlled by someone else. And here Paul says, I, therefore the prisoner of the Lord. I'm all his. He mandates, controls everything of my life. That would be a great sermon. And it was the sermon until I read verse 4. I wanted to preach on verse 1 until I got to verse 4. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling. Verse 5, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and the Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Come on, you can't go to Ephesians chapter 4 and not talk about this run of ones. Count them up. Count these ones up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There's something poetic. You and I can immediately realize, hey, 7, 7. 7 is just not a casual number in Scripture. It is given with some sacred, almost complete content. 7. Eugene Peterson says, this is not just a what was on the top of Paul's head. He put this together, repeating 1 7 times, calling for this unity in the faith. You look at these seven, while they stand as an affront to universalism and postmodern thinking of you're right, I'm right, we can all come from different directions. They're an affront to this thinking. At the same time, they're not so complete as to eliminate any sort of differences. There's one body, one spirit. You are called in one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. Woven in these ones is the theology of a Trinity. This oneness. Paul is calling for this unity. Paul is very concerned about the church. You want to put Ephesians in one word, it's the church. So he says, oneness. Eugene Peterson looks at this and says, you know, he said, I was walking once and somebody said to us, how long have you been married? He said, he was walking with his wife. We've been married some 20 years. And the man said, I knew it. How did you know? Said Eugene. He said, I knew it because you walk in unison. What happened? Eugene says, what happened as soon as he said that? We couldn't walk in unison. Have you ever tried to walk together, like consciously every step? All right, let's go. Let's go. Man, The minute you focus on the unity, on the unison, it's destroyed. If that becomes the objective, it's counterproductive. Just say to someone on the way out of church, you have a smooth walk, and then watch them walk away. Because it messes everything up. Tell two people, you guys walk together so well. They'll be bumping and... It's two factors that bring together a common goal and a common direction. We're going that distance, and we're going that direction. That's what brings unity. Oh, I wanted to preach on this passage, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 4 through 6. I really wanted it to be this passage. And it was until I read verse 11. He himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. Verse 12, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Till we all come to the unity of the faith, of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man. Ooh, that's strong language right there. To the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Do you hear his language? The measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That's huge. He says, look, he himself, Jesus, gave some to be apostles. He gave gifts. Why? For the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. And what will be the result? There will be a unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, and then that will mature to make a perfect man. We're afraid of that word, perfect. to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That we should no longer be children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. I read this passage, and this addresses a fundamental question that every churchgoer has. Every converted heart, when you enter into the family of Christ, the question you ask, a fundamental question, what is my part? What is my part? How do I work in this new family? Am I a part? Am I a leader? I mean, I have these kind of abilities, but in this family, am I a leader? Am I better here? Am I better there? It is a fundamental question every Christian asks. What is my part in the body? And so Paul, concerned about the church, picks it up in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. He says, he himself gave some to be this and others to be that. And three conclusions come from these gifts. The conclusion of unity, the conclusion of sanctification, perfection, and thirdly, a protection from false doctrine. That's what the church, Christ through the church, does. Ah, it would be really, really fun to preach on that passage. And it was the sermon until I read verse 21. If indeed you have heard him, I love Paul. He doesn't play nice. He plays for the max. If indeed, if you really think you are a follower of the Christ, if you've heard him and have been taught by him, if you want to claim Jesus, let me tell you what it's going to look like. If you want to claim Jesus, this is the consequence that you put off concerning your former conduct, the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, verse 22, skipping just one verse to verse 24, and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Back up to just that verse 21. If indeed, Paul says, if you have in fact been taught of Jesus, you want to claim to be a Christian? Let me tell you what it's going to look like. You're going to take off the old man and you're going to put on the new man. And this language Paul uses is not help. I've got a spot on my shirt. I've got to change shirts. He uses this language of total change. See, we want to play with this. No, I'll clean up the spot. No, Paul says, if indeed you have been taught of the Christ, if you have learned from the Jesus I follow, this is what's going to happen. You're going to take off the corrupt. There is going to be an old that's left behind and a new, hallelujah, put on. If indeed you've heard him and have been taught of him, as the truth is in Jesus. Beloved, Paul takes it to the end. He says, look, Judas could have claimed to be a follower of Jesus. Judas expressed public affection for Jesus. Public affection for Jesus is not what we're talking about. Hey, what's the title you call yourself by? What? No. He says, if you have heard and have been taught, I'll tell you what it will look like. There will be an old off and a new on. I really wanted to preach on that one. But then I read Ephesians 4, verse 26. Come on, you can't go to Ephesians 4, verse 26 without talking about this passage. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath. Come on, we've all used that, right? Your spouse has their back to you. You roll over and sweetly quote, "Sweetie, don't let the sun go down on your wrath." No. Paul here says, be angry and do not sin. He takes two different responses to anger. One is this, there's two types of people or two types of reaction to anger. One is the type that throws stuff and yells and they come out with it. And we kind of point at those people as, you know what, they've got a temper and they, you know, God needs to work on their heart. But there's this other type. There's this type that go in. You get angry and you go in. Paul says, be angry and do not sin. That's for those of you that go out with your anger. And then he says, do not let the sun go down on your wrath. That's for those of us that go in with our anger. Paul hits it both. He says, you can't let it be something between you. You can't hold it in. You can't let it go out. Give no place, verse 27, give no place to the devil. You want to know more of the context there? Paul is talking about the holding in, the letting it go, and the talking to others. He said, look, you can't give a place to the devil. What does he mean, a place to the devil? As soon as you share with somebody, you know what? Do you know what he did to me? There's a place for the devil. As soon as you pass along that emotion, there's a place for the devil. I'd really like to talk about that one. I wanted to preach on that one. But I read verse 32. So those were all almost sermons. But I read verse 32 and I said, this is the teaching. The final verse of chapter 4, be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God in Christ forgave you. As soon as I read it, I said, that's it. It turns out that verse 32 is the second of two bookends. The final verse closes a thought that Paul began earlier. He says, be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as in Christ forgave you. Just as you were treated, treat others. Let's just say for the purpose of illustration that you have matured in sanctification and in a mature representation of Jesus. Let's just say you've grown as a Christian and you no longer need regular forgiveness for the purpose of illustration. Because oftentimes where we sit now, we say, you know what? I am at an understanding. I am at a place with God. And we treat others as if they ought to be where we are at. But Paul uses not the present, but the past tense. When he says, treat others as Christ forgave you. Don't, if you've advanced in your Christian maturity, that's okay. But don't do it from that point. Start where you started. When Jesus had to keep picking you up, and working with you on your habits, being patient with you. And Paul ends the chapter with this invitation, this calling to treat others as we have past tense been treated. But that's the second of the two bookends. It actually begins in verse 1, the very first verse is the first of these two bookends I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, we just talked about that. Listen to his invitation. Beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which you were called. There's two key words there. Worthy and calling. They're operative. I beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. This is the first bookend in what Paul really wants to say in chapter 4. If we take the first verse and the last verse, they hold everything else together. I beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which you were called. Don't forget, this is Paul's pleading. Don't forget where you have come from. Don't forget your roots. The story is told that Bill Gates, sitting at a restaurant once with his son, when the waiter took their payment and became a bit puzzled when Mr. Gates Sr., that is Bill, gave only a $5 tip, richest man in the world, where his son, sitting at the same table, had included a $500 tip. The waiter, not wanting to complain, but just paused for a moment in just a little bit of confusion. When Bill caught it, said, is there something wrong? And the waiter just said, quite honestly, I mean, I'm getting more than I deserve, certainly, but I'm just confused how your son would give 500 and you would only give five. And Bill Gates says, the difference is he's the son of the richest man in the world. I'm the son of a woodcutter. I haven't forgotten where I've come from. I don't get your tipping lesson from Bill Gates. But Bill Gates' point is, I still know I'm a poor boy whose dad is a woodcutter. And I wonder if Paul's frustration with this church in Ephesus was that they had moved so quickly, forgetting that it was just a few years earlier that they had been given the gospel. And I wonder if his frustration with the Campion Church would be, you've forgotten your roots, where you've come from, what God has done for you, where God has brought you through. The calling, what is that calling? It's actually in chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Do you hear the calling? Holy and without blame before him, having predestined us to what is, I love that word, adoption. As sons by Christ Jesus to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved, capital B. That's our calling. Our calling was that God, before the foundation of the world, predestined us through his son, Jesus Christ, to be his royal children. That's the calling he's put on our lives. And Paul, to the church in Ephesus, to the church at Campion, says, be worthy of the calling that God has put on your life. I beseech you to recognize where you have come from, that through Christ, God adopted you. He's made us accepted. I wonder if the church of Ephesus had forgotten that they had just been given this gift a few years earlier and now had begun to move on and treat each other as if others needed to somehow do extra or needed to keep up with them. Oh, Paul says, Your calling was to be blameless and holy because you are a son of the eternal God. You are royalty. And the brothers and sisters that sit around you, they're royalty. September 6, 1997, CNN ran the headlines with dignity and tears. That's what the headlines read. What was the context on that September 6th? The opening line was, "With the eyes of a mournful nation and a curious world fixed upon them, Princess Diana's two young princes paid tribute to their mother Saturday with a solemn, dignified walk behind her funeral." With the eyes of a mournful nation and a curious world fixed upon them, Princess Diana's two young princes paid tribute to their mother Saturday with a solemn, dignified walk. Those two princes walking behind her casket, their hands behind their back, their faces set. The world noted that they looked like princes. They're a prince. Paul says, I want you to know to walk worthy of the calling. You were called to be princes and princesses. Now walk according to your calling. That the world may know when the headlines read about your life, they will read, they walked in dignity. They walked like a prince. They walked like princesses. They were royalty. And so the question, the calling is that we were called to be sons and daughters of God, adopted through Christ. That's our calling. But how is it? How is it to walk worthy? How is it to walk worthy? And here it is. Verse 2 and 3 of chapter 4. Right after Paul says, "I beseech you to walk worthy of the calling of which you were called," he says this, "with all one, lowliness, two, gentleness, long suffering, three, bearing one another in love, four, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit, five." He gives us five descriptions of what it looks like to walk as royalty. What does it mean to walk as a prince or as a princess of God? He said, here it is. Walk in lowliness, humility, gentleness, long-suffering, bearing one another in love. You want to know what that bearing one another? We don't say bearing one another. It means putting up with one another. I'm putting up with one another in love and endeavoring to keep the unity. Five descriptors of what it looks like to walk worthy of the calling, to walk like a prince or as a princess of God. What does it look like? Humility, gentleness, long-suffering, that's just patience. Putting up with one another in love and endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit. Look at those five. Look at these five here in verse 2 and 3. Tell me one person that you can picture in your mind that plays those five out the best on planet Earth. Who comes to your mind when you think of they were humble, they were gentle, they were very patient, they put up with a lot of stuff I did, and they kept the unity in our family? Who comes to your mind? It's your mom. Tell me I'm not telling the truth. It's not the dads. It's not big sister, little brother. Yeah, those five describe a mom. I wonder when Paul wrote this if he thought, the best picture of a child of God, of a follower of the Christ, the best example we have on earth is a mom. And he wrote it out describing exactly that. Living as a Christian is a lot like being a mom. A picture of following Jesus. Someone that's patient, humble, puts up with us. Living as a Christian is a lot like being a mom. We're all thankful for our moms this weekend, celebrating it. If it would be of any help, as you reflect on walking worthy of the calling of which you've been called, put your mom's picture up. Because when somebody irritates you, how did she treat you when you irritated her? When somebody doesn't listen to you, how did your mom treat you when you didn't listen to her? When somebody's mean to you, how did your mom treat you when you were mean to her? Being a Christian is a lot like being a mom. And Paul bookends chapter 4, Ephesians chapter 4, with, you be worthy of the calling of which you were called. Why? Verse 32, because Christ, everything he's asking of you to do, he is doing to you. So what is our prayer today? What is our prayer today? My prayer, that we go back to our roots. Go back to the place where we realized, wow, God, you're really good to me. And there's no better place. There's no bigger, more beautiful picture than the cross. So I wish together we would pray this prayer of hymn number 320, near the cross. Go back to your roots. We all started there. Go back there. When you think about how you're going to treat someone else, go back to where you saw God treat you at the cross. As we sing our hymn, the deacons, the ushers, will collect our morning tithes and offerings in baskets. They will also collect a Connect card. If you are a guest today at Campion, there's a card in the pew back in front of you. Fill that out. We have a gift we want to send you. On the back of that card, there's next steps you can take with Jesus. If you want to be baptized or join Bible studies, you mark that in and fill in your contact information. If you want to be involved in ministry and giving your gifts, write that on the back in the comments section or share a prayer request. We want to pray for what's on your heart. You can put those Connect cards in the offering bags as they pass as well. Let's sing together. George, near the cross.
312.
312.
Yeah. Stay seated for the first couple verses, and then when they're through, then we'll stand for the third and fourth verse.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. Near the cross. us, O Lamb of God, bring his sins before me. Help me walk from day to day with his shadows o'er me.
Keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and give you peace. May the Lord lift his countenance on this church according to Ephesians chapter 4. Amen.
Just one more word. We're glad you've joined us today. You're always welcome to join us here in worship. But we want to be available to you. If you have a prayer request, we have a prayer team that are eager to be praying for you. If you want to connect with a pastor, ask a question. If you feel you'd like to help support these teachings, being online, I want to invite you to contact the number on the screen, 970-667-7403. Or the website. We'll put that on the screen for you. You go there, you can contact us, leave a prayer request, connect with us. We'd be honored to hear from you and how we can help you in your spiritual journey. But until next time, know that Jesus is searching for you.